Okay, great. Yeah, sorry for the difficulties and many thanks to the Package and Con organizers, to the committee for organizing this and for allowing me to speak. So yeah, today we are going to talk about the OCaml Package Manager, the OPM. It's not a very frequently discussed package manager for one reason or another, not sure why. But it definitely deserves more attention because OCaml the language deserves more attention, I believe. But in this case, I'm completely unbiased because I only contribute to the ecosystem, but not to OPM itself. So, but first, let's talk about what OPM is for people who are not yet familiar with it. So OPM is the OCaml Package Manager. OCaml was first released in 1996. But it was relatively late to acquire a package manager that can use remote repositories. So it's not like 57 years like with Fortran, but still a pretty long time. So before that, there was only a local package manager named findlib. It can manage library link, but it didn't have a remote repository. And now OPM even has competitors. It's the Easy Package Manager that was released in 2018 that is more NPM-like. And OPM is anything but, which we are going to discuss. So, and who exactly is Daniil Baturin? So I've been using OCaml since 2014. I got really excited about the language. It's a typed, strict, eager functional language with a very fast compiler that targets multiple native architectures and bytecode, and that's very pleasant to write, at least for me. So, and since around 2017, I've been also contributing to the package repository and to multiple OCaml libraries, and also maintaining multiple packages, so both applications and libraries, and even fixed a bug in the OCaml once, and can stop bragging about it. So. Yeah, but I'm not a maintainer of the OPM repository or OPM itself, so in this case, this is an outsider perspective. So I'm merely a contributor. So something that immediately draw attention about OPM is that some design choices are quite unusual. So first of all, even though it is released in this decade, it doesn't use project lab installations. So the libraries don't go to the project directory, and there is no package log file. And another unusual point is that the repository management is centralized, so there is no self-service package publishing. To balance it, the good points are excellent repository maintenance practices, very extensive CI checks that prevent broken package from appearing in the repository. Ease of making and adding third-party repos, and it's very nice UX. So, for example, the shell integration for even for minority shells like Fish, not only for Bash, so it pretty much works on any Unix system, and also works on Windows. So the UX is not as nice, but it's workable. And some weak points are cross-compilation and relatively large metadata size that you need to download. So now let's get to the details. So regarding per directory installations, so with OPM or Cargo or many other package managers, so you create a project directory and you run npm install something, and it creates a local directory in the project directory, and it installs everything there. It's how Rust behaves, how Golang behaves, and that's not how OPM behaves. So OPM has a concept of switches. A switch is more or less like virtual environment. A switch includes a compiler and some installed packages. So when you create a switch, it always creates a compiler installations, and then you can install packages into that installation. Normally it's in a .opm slash switch name. It can be either just version, or you can assign some descriptive name if you want to use it for a project, for example. And then every library or every package goes under that path. So all libraries are by default shared between all projects you have on your machine, because OPM and your project are not tightly coupled. And not only there are no log files, but in fact, most packages, even end-user applications, leave upper dependency bounds open. So it's just assumed that it's going to work when people upgrade their libraries. And I have to say there's excellent backward compatibility culture in the ecosystem. And since break sometimes, but it's not really a frequent occurrence. So I'm not really missing log files there, even though sometimes since the break, it's easy to pin packages if you need. So yeah, regarding switches. So a switch includes a compiler and install patches. One good thing that I really love is import and export. So you can OPM import or OPM export, and it loads or prints a list of all patches that are installed. So you can easily clone a switch. I can also use multiple switches, the same compiler version, if you feel like it. In fact, creating a switch involves bootstrapping a compiler. So since OCaml targets both native and bytecode, it can be easily bootstrapped because the upstream tables come with bytecode executable of the compiler, current compiler version. So first use C compiler to build the byte time, the executor, and then it uses the byte executable to bootstrap the rest of the compiler for native machine. And it's a very fast process, so I have a really modest development machine. It's i5 Intel MVC, and it takes about 5 minutes for me, and on even more modest machines, it's more than 10 minutes. So it's not a problem. And that allows the repository to include many packs for compilers. So since they're all virtual packages, so they go back to 23. To version 3.7 that no one actually uses but available. So if you suddenly need to compile some old application that somehow doesn't support newer versions, then it's still possible, not problem. So now let's get to the centralized repository management part. So I'm generally advocate of a proponent of decentralization, but in this case, I have to admit that centralized management has been a positive experience all around, except for somewhat longer time to general availability. In practice, it's usually a few days if the package is not broken. And if it's broken, then of course it can take longer to fix it and to get it reviewed again. But the first unusual point is that there's no self-publishing. All contributions to the repository are made by creating a pull request against its Git repository. And there's an OPM plugin for automating PR creation. But it's still a PR. It shows you a TIFF and asks you whether you want to create a pull request. And once you create it, it's waiting for human review. But there's also very extensive CI checks, so humans don't really have to do that much review. So what are the benefits of centralization? First, anyone can fix anyone's packaging issues. So if someone discovers that an old package is broken for a new library version, they can send a pull request to add an upper bound before an upstream fix is available. Likewise, taking over someone else's package is relatively straightforward. So if the old and new maintainers agree that someone should take over, they can just start sending pull requests in the OPM repository. And there's no need to wait for anyone to pass the original Git repository to the new maintainer. And, Obviously, it makes supply chain attacks more difficult because a maintainer cannot sneakily update it, and a malicious actor that takes over someone's account also cannot modify the upon package by modifying the upstream ball. So overall, I think it's been a good scene, and I'm pretty happy with the experience. So now regarding the CI checks, they're really quite extensive, and I still find it quite impressive. So if you look in build log, so you see, well, in this case, not very old. It's multiple distros, it's multiple compilers, and it's multiple architectures. So it's going back to the 14th version of the compiler still, just in case someone is using it. So architectures including like IBM mainframes and PowerPC 64. So that's why broke packages are relatively rare occurrence. And somewhat recently, they also introduced launch check. So by default, it checks whether the package supports the newest versions it claims to support. So if the upper bound is left open, then it's tested with the most recent versions. But since a few months back, the CI also tries to install the package with all the dependencies it claims to support. And for many packages, the answer is that not. And, it led to quite a few patches to fix that. Somewhat frustratingly, it also led to unrelated packages looking broken because they had transitive dependencies that were affected by incorrect lower bounds. And I actually was quite happy to contribute to that process and help fix my package so that could actually work with proper lower bounds because it's better user experience for everyone. And as I said, it's easy to make alternative repositories. So if you enter the repository, for example, it's my package, the support website generator. So it's a package, so package name, and you have a directory per package version. So if you enter such a directory, you can see the OPM file. An unusual scene is that it's custom format, not TOML, not JSON. So it's not very hard to write, and there's also a library for manipulating it automatically if you want. That library is not the nicest thing, but it's usable if you have to. So, and the repository is also seen. So there's a link to stream table, but artifacts, upstream tables are not stored inside the repository. And that also makes creating alternative repositories easier because you can just copy metadata files and make your updates, but you don't need to clone every upstream table. And some companies are using private repositories to avoid things when they don't want them to move. So yeah, it's not very hard. And there are multiple community repositories. It's a repository for Windows that is getting deprecated because OPM is working with Windows by default right now. It's cross-repositories for cross-compiling for Windows and Android, and it's development multi-core repository. So even though the official repository is centralized, that's nothing stopping people from making their own and adding their own. And regarding Windows, yes, it mostly just works now, though it depends on SIGWIN. I'm only building binaries on Windows. I'm not developing that platform. But I can say that I haven't run into difficulty building it. Though people complain that sometimes using with developing environments is not as smooth on Windows. So there's still some work left there. But my personal pain point is cross-compilation. So OCaml itself does pretty well. The build system does pretty well. OCaml find the findlib does pretty well. But the problem is that right now you need separate repositories for cross-tool chains. and there is not much community interested. I try to make a tool to automate the common adjustments that cross packages need, but there's not much interest, and I switched to building on native Windows, on Windows Virtual Machine from building with the cross-tool chain, because I simply cannot keep up with the official repository, and there aren't many people who also want to help the maintainer of the repository. But I hope in the end, OPM itself acquires ready for easier cross-compilation, and it becomes an issue eventually. So yeah, another thing that I'm not very fond about is the size of the metadata. So since it downloads the entire repository locally, it's about 200 megabytes of data, and it's not very small. So I suppose at some point, maybe some kind of proxy and a sync client would be nice, because it will reduce the amount of data transferred and unpacked. But I can live with it, but I still would like probably to see a sync version of the repository client. So I think that's all from me. So if you have any questions, then feel free to ask and I'll try to answer. So of course I cannot answer anything, sorry, everything, and I'm also not speaking on behalf of the OPM maintainers. Remember that.
Okay, thanks for your talk. Are there any questions from folks out there? I don't actually see any online. I don't see any here, but all right. I think we will move on to the next talk then. Thanks, Daniel.
Actually, Jack. I'll answer the questions in the chat.
Oh, great. Okay. Yeah. So, what do you do for integrity of repository metadata?
What they do is there are checksums repository files. Let me reshare my screen briefly.
Okay. I'll put it in if you share it.
So if you look in the repository, you have MD5 and SHA 512 checksums. So if the upstream tarball somehow changes, then the package will stop building because we fail the integrity check. There is no support for digital signatures right in the files yet, so I hope it will be added at some point.
Okay, any other questions? It looks like Jack has more follow-on questions. This will be the last one because we got to go to the next talk. I think Richard is already sharing, so it's great.